You are listening to Megiddo Radio. Megiddo Radio is a radio ministry of Megiddo Films. For more, visit our website at www.megiddofilms.org. Good evening, everybody. Welcome. This is Paul Flynn with Megiddo Radio for the 23rd of December, 2014. Thank you all for tuning in. This is probably going to be the last show for 2014. The reason I'm doing this show this week, based on the topic, Christmas, Christian liberty, and antinomianism. Now, I was hoping to continue on with the issue of the Sabbath, and this very much ties in with the issue of the Sabbath and many of the themes I was touching upon the last day. So I would encourage you to listen to the last show, maybe first, in order to understand a lot of the arguments that I'm going to be bringing up in today's show. Probably going to be the last show of 2014, mainly because it's very quiet at the end of the year, as we all know. And I really, you know, I want to have at least one show a week. And I don't want to treat December 25th any different to any other day. And I mean, when one gives up, quote unquote, or repents from the idolatrous, superstitious holy day that is Christmas, it's quite a bit of a detox program. Pulling yourself away from family members, and not that you're completely shunning them or anything like that. I don't think you should do that. But there becomes a period of time where you're trying to find out which battles are worth fighting. I mean, share the gospel with people. I mean, now, if people really ask you, no, I think when people ask you, why don't you, you know, celebrate Christmas is a wonderful time and a wonderful opportunity to share the gospel. And there's a myth kind of that you have to observe Christmas in order to share the gospel. That's not true at all. I remember Martin Lloyd-Jones pointed out one time, and I quoted at the end of O Chaos and Confusion, Modern Church, that this whole idea that the world expects us to be the same as they are and act the same as they are, and the reason why, and this is what Lloyd-Jones said, the reason why people were attracted to Christ was because he was different. The world expects us to be different. And in order to win them to Christ by being the same as them and observing Christmas and just doing everything else that like them is a theological and psychological blunder. Now, he wasn't talking about Christmas in that art when he was talking about that, but the same principle applies. We often think, well, we got to do everything they're doing. And no, we don't. When it comes to holy days, holidays, setting days aside, which what a holy day is, a holiday, for it's a religious thing to set a day aside, to cease from your work and to observe something else. How many people work on Christmas Day? Very few people. What kind of works are done usually on Christmas Day? Works of necessity and mercy often. You know, doctors, nurses, and people like that will work on Christmas Day. And people who cannot, would abhor such a standard being held for the Lord's Day, would not say anything against such observance of Christmas Day. Now, the argument that often gets put forward, and this is what I wanted to deal with, especially being the 23rd of December, and I was going to do a show next Friday, just as normal, but I said for the topic that we're covering today, it would benefit people if it came up before December 25th. If you've already gone through decorating your entire house, and you've already done December 25th, now most people have already decorated a home and done all that kind of thing weeks ago, but maybe this will make people think. You know, be brilliant. Check everything against the Word of God. Don't be basing it on what I'm saying or anybody else is saying. Acts 17:11. Because the Bereans were more noble than those in Thessalonica because they tested the Word. Even what the Apostle Paul was saying. those noble Bereans who checked everything that was said against the word of God. But people feel like, we already know everything when it comes to the Lord's Day, the Sabbath. Do we? And these would be the issues, brethren, I myself would have ran from. This is why I did the last show on the Christian Sabbath, the first day of the week. No, I am, you know, people want to throw around, that's Seventh-day Adventism. Well, number one, Seventh-day Adventists hold to a Saturday Sabbath. And so I think the Hebrew Roots Movement do as well, if I'm not mistaken. I'm hoping to do a show on the Hebrew Roots Movement in the new year. But it's what I've been doing really to prepare for a lot of these things is spending a lot of time studying the moral law and the difference between the moral law and the ceremonial law and the implications of it, how it starts right back in creation. Same law, same standard that man is supposed to attain to, which is perfect obedience. And what is that standard? It's summarized in the Ten Commandments. And this is why we go through this. And to say that, it's moral, ceremonial, moral, is ludicrous. Why stick a ceremonial law in the middle of it? And why is this moral law, which is perpetual, doesn't mention the day of the week? It just says 6 days thou shalt labor, and the seventh of those 6 days will be a Sabbath rest, one in seven. No mention of Saturday, no mention of the seventh day of the week. But they were following the pattern laid upon creation. God was the one who set apart the first holy day, and for about 2,500 years, that was the only thing the church, which started back in Genesis 3:15, observed. Well, actually, not even Genesis 3:15, before the fall. See, this is the thing about it. The Sabbath is not a burdensome thing, you know, for people, you know, like sinful Israel. This is something that Adam observed. The Sabbath was given for Adam, or for man, sorry. Not man for Sabbath. You know, so it was for man's benefit. It's supposed to be our delight. But we don't see it as our delight. We see Christmas. We see Easter. We see all these other set-apart holy days of the imposed church calendar, which came from Romanist traditions. No, this was not the Church of Rome, a lot of the stuff came from. But this tendencies to look true to man-made, the inventions of man's brains, tradition, that kind of tradition, adding to what the church does and we do in our worship, led to what eventually was the Roman Catholic Church. The great fork in the road that was seen during the Reformation with Martin Luther siding with the normative principle, which is espoused by the great majority of evangelicals today. Probably a majority of evangelicals you meet today, unless they have maybe studied the Westminster Standards or something like that, agree with the normative standard. Normative standard was also agreed with by Martin Luther. The normative principle was basically this. If the Bible does not explicitly actually condemn it, then it's allowed. However, on the other hand, Calvin's, not sure about Zwingli, but from what Calvin, Beza, Scottish Presbyterianism, John Knox, well before, there's a really good talk actually on Sermon Audio if you want to look at it. It's John Knox's Ministry to the English, I think it's called. It's given by Reverend David Silverside, who's the minister in Loch Brooklyn Reformed Presbyterian Church in Northern Ireland. And he goes through that John Knox held to this principle, the regulative principle of worship, well before he met John Calvin. It's a really interesting talk, and the great dividing and how basically why Anglicanism is such a mess. Because it didn't believe in the regulative principle of worship. Lutheranism was such a mess. I mean, given over to liberalism very, very quickly because they did not adhere only to what was commanded in the scriptures. And it was, see, sometimes when people look at the Reformation, they just look at, well, there was Martin Luther, John Calvin, and everything spawned out of that. It's too simplistic. A major thing, major, say, development was a further understanding of the second commandment. The second commandment states that thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above or that is on the earth beneath or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them nor serve them, for I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children of the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. It says, thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image, or any likeness of anything in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in heaven under the earth. This is in relation to worship. Any graven image. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them. And the more, you see, we have to realize with the Ten Commandments, this is not the entire sphere, you could say, or scope of the moral law. This is a summarization of the moral law in these Ten Commandments. These Ten Commandments can be stretched out further. I mean, thou shalt not kill, for example, or I'll take the adultery one, actually. Thou shalt not commit adultery. It's not just, you know, like the Pharisees understood it. It wasn't just, well, I haven't committed adultery with any person. Jesus said to them, if you look upon a woman with lust, you've committed adultery already in your heart. So this was showing that this commandment, the seventh commandment, was not merely in the outward. It was also from the heart that law was supposed to be kept. It wasn't just, it had a positive aspect of, you know, meditating and commitment to your wife and spouse, and not just a negative aspect. So there was more, thou shalt not kill. We're not supposed to hate our brother either, because from our heart, we violate this commandment. And the 10th commandment, then, thou shalt not covet, which is regulating all of your heart, your sinful desire to have something. So the law was not just this kind of superficial, well, I won't make an idol, I won't make a graven image, as long as I'm not bowing down to it, it's okay. This is not merely, well, obviously this is wrong in creating of idols, and bowing down to them, of course, is wrong. And it's one of the biggest problems, you know, like the Puritans, for example, had with the Book of Common Prayer. When it came to the Lord's table, they did not want to kneel down before the sacrament because this signified kind of some kind of worship of the elements. And so we cannot take a superficial view of this commandment. I just want to quote here from the Westminster Larger Catechism on the second commandment, which states that it condemns all superstitious devices corrupting the worship of God, adding to or taking from it, whether invented and taken up ourselves or received by tradition from others. Though under the title of antiquity, custom, devotion, good intent, or any other pretense whatsoever. So this is much more greater to extent. Christians today will only, by and large, reject something based upon the fact that it comes from a complete heathen. No, no, no. We're to reject any form of worship that comes from men's brains. It doesn't matter whether they're professing Christian or anybody else. It doesn't matter if it's Martin Luther, even John Calvin. Whoever it is, if it's a man's brains, it is to be rejected. And this is what it means, any likeness of in heaven above or earth beneath. Anything that you worship, anything, this is connected with worship. And this has a very broad application. This is why it's wrong for images of Christ, because we worship Christ. He is the deity. He is the second person of the Godhead. We are to worship him. So we are in a corrupt, how we worship him. Christ said we are to worship in spirit and in truth in John chapter 4. So if we have a false understanding and say, well, how can a picture corrupt our understanding? Well, we're told that God would not reveal any similitude in Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 12 to 16, lest he corrupt Moses. He spoke out of the fire, the bush, but he did no similitude to the scene. And in like manner here, not to create any likeness, any image, any representation, any similitude, and the second commandment's really fleshed out more in Deuteronomy 4, chapters, verse 12 to 16. Thou shalt not bow down to self. And again, it's related to worship. Thou shalt not serve them. To serve something is to worship something. What do you spend your money on? That is what you worship. This is why it says the love of money is the root of all evil. You serve money. You want more money. Do you want more money or do you want more God? And that is, again, I mean, if you, there are successful entrepreneurs and people who love to be rich. They want a big bank balance, lots of cars and things like that. If that's where your joy is, if that's what you serve, then that is your God. That is what you worship. This is what the second commandment. This second commandment is about worship. Don't create anything false or from man's imagination. For I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity, the sin of this creating idolatrous worship of the fathers upon the children of the third and fourth generation of them that hate me. Now, notice he is not talking to heathens. Now, he's giving them the moral law. This law has existed from creation. It is the very character of God, but he is talking to a covenant people, Israel, which was the visible church. Not all Israel were of Israel, but it was the visible church and treated as the visible church. It was the church in the old covenant. Israel was also a state at the same time, so it was a unique situation, and the jurisdiction of the state and the church were different. I mean, you had the elders over the congregation of the Lord. They were to rule. This is all the way through Exodus. They were also called the rulers of the congregation at various points. So you had that. And you also had the state, which is the magistrates. Judges talks about the magistrates. And those, like Samuel, for example, how Israel at various points, the magistrates would not enforce the law of God. And each man did what was right in his own eyes. And when we're coming before to worship God, we often come with what is right in our own eyes. So the first table of the law is related to our relationship with God. The third commandment, thou shalt not take the Lord in vain, the Lord thy God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless with taking his name in vain. And then the fourth is remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. We talked about that the last day, what that means today. And 6 days thou shalt labor, and then the seventh is a Sabbath of rest, 1 in 7 days to be set aside, and it traces and it links it right back in verse 11 to creation. Again, we dealt with that the last day. Who has the right? Who sanctifies a day? God. No one else. Now, you have one example. This is after the Decalogue was given, of probably the first example of a feast. Another name for feast was Holy Day, a feast being held, festival. Again, these words are interchangeable, festival, feast, and all this kind of thing. Holiday, set aside Aaron. Aaron, once he was commanded by the people, he capitulated to their sinful desires, and Moses has gone up into the mountain. He hadn't returned in quick enough for the people of Israel, and they asked. And we know that many people know the story of the account where they took all their earrings and the gold and they melted it down into a golden calf and they worshipped it. But Aaron also set a day aside, a feast, and that was a holy day. See, holy days and worship. I mean, to worship means to celebrate something. Oh, we're celebrating Christmas. You're worshiping what? See, what are we to celebrate? No, I said, oh, we're celebrating the Lord's birth. Where are we told to do that? No, we are told how we are to worship God, not to worship him as a baby in a manger. The way from the imagination of Francis of Assisi, the Franciscan monk, in the 13th century. Under, I believe he was under Innocent III. This is, see, most of these traditions, not condemned at all by the modern evangelical church, are accepted because apparently they're not condemned anywhere. We're supposed to be told explicitly that we will not take these things. Now, the argument often is, well, it's a part of our Christian liberty. Now, in preparing for this show, and I wanted to look at what is Christian liberty? Is it as presented by the majority of the evangelical church? Now, I just want to quote here from an article which was released. This is an old article from Christian Research Institute, which asked the question, should Christians celebrate Christmas? Now, I'm not going to spend a lot of time with this article, just to give you an example of often what kind of arguments. These kind of arguments are all over the place. I've seen them so often, and that's why I kind of wanted to deal with them here. He says one of the reasons, you know, he gives a couple of really terrible arguments that the Jehovah's Witnesses say, you know, just trying to tie in Jehovah's Witnesses, bit of a kind of a, you know, I mean, I get this kind of thing, oh, well, Jehovah's Witnesses are against it, so we must be for it. Oh, that's great logic. I mean, oh, we're not like the Jehovah's Witnesses, we actually observe Christmas. Well, you're also like the Roman Catholics. Do you want to be like the Roman Catholics? Where does this go? I mean, even a broken clock is right twice a day. Just because Rome does it or Jehovah's Witnesses do it or whoever else does it doesn't necessarily make it wrong. We need biblical backing for it. And, okay. He says here, what the Bible does not forbid, either explicitly or by implication by some moral principle, is permissible to the Christian as long as it is edifying. Now, it is not edifying to have our view of Christ, the man, the God, that man, that God, who conquered, who sits at the right hand of the majesty on high, and intercedes for his people, and is the mediator of the new covenant, the covenant of grace, that spiritual, those spiritual blessings upon his covenant people, as promised back in Jeremiah 31:31-33, and then you pour out his spirit upon all flesh. This triumphant king, who as a man, as a God, triumphed over death. We want to think of him as just a baby, meditate upon him as a baby? Oh, Rome would love nothing better. How is that edifying? But also, the problem I have with all this is Christian liberty has been seen as a kind of a thing where, well, the Bible doesn't talk about that. Anything the Bible, and I hate this explanation of it, where the Bible doesn't speak on it, we should, you know, it's up to our, you know, judgment. The Bible doesn't speak about it. I don't like when people say that. And you see, the problem is with that is the Bible does speak about everything spiritual. Now, take a little second to absorb that. It may not explicitly say, thou shalt not observe Christmas, for example. But by good and necessary consequence, which is also called logic, we can determine what Scripture teaches on any given spiritual issue. Now, this is not talking about how many times a week, you know, you have a shower or something like that. Let's not get into ridiculous arguments like that. This is talking about anything spiritual, and Christmas is undeniably spiritual, so the Bible does have something to say about it. Often with the Christian liberty argument, and I do believe in Christian liberty. Look into my, as laid out, especially in the Westminster Standards, Westminster Confession of Faith, chapter 21. Chapter 20. Chapter 21 is a Sabbath day and a religious worship, but chapter 20 deals with Christian liberty. And this Christian liberty has been used as a kind of an excuse for antinomians who don't believe we're not under law, we're under grace. Yeah. And by the way, that means those who are in Christ are not under the curse of the law, and they're not under the obligation to keep, we're still to obey the law, the moral law, not the ceremonial law, but we're not under the curse of the law. We cannot be justified by the curse of the law. If we're under the law, as Paul writes, in that sense, we are not under grace, and we're under condemnation of the law. We have to be careful of taking some of these statements and putting them completely in isolation. I mean, if we have no desire to follow, if you love me, keep my commandments, the Lord Jesus Christ said. 1 John 5:3 talks about what is love is command keeping. Why? To follow Christ, you see, this is the thing. To follow Christ means to follow the moral law. And what do I mean by that? His very character is the moral law. It's the very image of God. It's the law written on men's hearts. That's the way we're creating an image of God. Now, those who are lost, the law written in their hearts is completely under darkness, is held. It's withheld held down, you could say, on unrighteousness. It's suppressed. It's under darkness and in the foolishness of our hearts. We reject it. But that's why everybody knows that a God exists. You don't have to convince an atheist that a God exists. But he holds that truth. He represses it. He hates it. He holds it down, as it describes in Romans 1:18. That is such an important passage of Scripture to understand, especially when witnessing to people. But Christian liberty is taking as this kind of, as long as you're convinced in your own mind. Romans chapter 14, verses 5 and 6. And it's also used as a common argument against the Sabbath. Well, you know, it doesn't matter. In the New Covenant, one man esteems one day. And this verse, I've seen quoted time and time again. Romans chapter 14, verses 5 and 6. One man esteemeth one day above another, another esteemeth every day alike. Let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind. He that regardeth a day regardeth unto the Lord, and he that regardeth not a day to the Lord, he doth not regard it. He that eateth, let eateth to the Lord, for he giveth God thanks. For he that giveth, eateth not to the Lord, he eateth not and giveth God thanks. So, from those verses, and look, and if you just read those verses, it looks like, oh, well, you know, it doesn't really matter. One man esteems one day alike. As long as you're persuaded and it's within your Christian liberty to do this. Is this what Paul is teaching? Now, if it is, it's a complete contradiction of the rest of the Bible. Is Paul teaching something different to the rest of the Scriptures? Which states that all Scripture is given by inspiration of God, not just the New Testament, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 to 17. Number one, he cannot possibly be talking about that, but you're also missing the context. Romans 14 is talking about the weaker brother. And it says, him that is weak in the faith, verse 1, receive ye, but not the doubtful disputations. Receive him was weak, but not the person who's bringing up contentions and strivings about the law, etc., and so on, causing strife, whatnot. For one believeth, verse 2, that he may eat all things, another who is weak eateth herbs. What's it referring to? Eating. Colossians 2, verses 16 to 17 talks about this. Let no man judge you in terms of, or bring a bondage of you back into the ceremonial law. Eating. There was laws for eating under the ceremonial law. What you could do, there was restrictions on everything. This is part of the ceremonial law. Now, at one point, you see, the Roman church, and lots of churches were like this, there was a mixture between Jewish and Gentile believers, according to the flesh, now I mean. So, Now, according to spirit, who is circumcised of heart is a Jew, according to the spirit. But it's talking about the weak brother, and there's some weak Jews in here stating, and we do not want to, just say somebody's weak and something struggling with something, we don't want to use our liberty in Christ to cause them to stumble. For example, the Bible is not against drinking alcohol. For goodness sake, it is using the Lord's table. It says wine. It does not say ribena. It doesn't say grape juice. That wasn't it never existed until 200 years ago. Well, it's just grape juice, but that's another issue. The Bible says wine. Wine. Wine is wine. Bread is bread. They're the two elements of the Lord's table. But just say somebody's come out of a drinking background, as I have. Somebody's been a heavy drinker. And is now wrongly believing because it just caused them so much pain. Now, it's a little bit of a different situation in Romans 14, but this is the one that people usually relate to. That you cannot drink alcohol. Now, if he's convinced that, don't be kind of like cracking open, flaunting wine. Oh, do you want to have a sip? You know, right after he's been struggling with it for ages. Now, I pray that he'd be delivered from that. Now, for example, I can have a glass of wine probably twice a year. It doesn't have any effect on me anymore. But I remember years ago, it had a complete grip over me, but the issue was my heart. This is where the problem came from. I desired it because I lost control, things like that. Now, the difference here is the Jews, spoken about here lawfully at one point, kept the ceremonial law, and even Paul kept the ceremonial law right up until Acts 21. He practiced circumcision, etc., and so on. And this is what led to the First Council of Jerusalem, a dispute that was affected the entire church, and that's why you had that first synod. And it was a ruling of all the elders of the churches that was binding on the church. No, it's binding because it was biblical. Just because a council says something doesn't make it true. If it's biblical, yes. So here we have the lawful keeping, and said, let not him that eateth despise him that eateth not. Let him. So the person who doesn't eat, this person, just say the person, right? He's coming converted from Judaism. You know, he's in the old covenant, lawfully accepting and doing these things. You, Jew, who's aware now the ceremonial law is done away in Christ, you're aware of the teachings of Colossians chapter 2, do not despise the other weak convert who doesn't know about these things, who maybe the teaching isn't as clear. Don't despise this person. Let not that which eateth not judge him, for God hath received him. And this kind of goes as well, this does go for the weak believer who's not well taught on whatever it is. For example, I think we should be charitable and gracious towards, especially new believers who are looking and say, celebrating Christmas, believing they're doing the right thing. Don't despise them. I mean, this is one of the problems I have with people who are really anti-Christmas, sorry. And in their zeal, sometimes we can lambast people. Don't despise him, but encourage him in the right direction. For God has received him. Now, I think there's a difference. You can take that too far, and people can be living horrendous lives, complete denials of their profession of faith. And then people say, well, you know, he's weak in the faith. We need to receive him. No. That's a different issue. And for another day, but we are supposed to withdraw from such people. But that is different. This is somebody who's weak in the faith and doesn't have sufficient teaching. Number 4, verse 4, who art thou that judgest another man's servant? You don't know how much instruction he's got. To his own master standeth he, followed, yea, he be holded up, for God is able to make him stand again, and it talks about that. So what you're talking about is Jews, really the difference between Jews who abandoned the ceremony laws, God, and some are still observing it. Do not, that liberty, that freedom, it does talk about Christian liberty here, but what it's talking about here is freedom from the ceremonial law. Oh, wow, you don't have to keep all these regulations and dietary laws and all these holy days. The one holy day remaining was the one that was right back for creation, but all these other things, they're gone. What a weight relief. Because when the church was young, you know, childlike, it needed all these aids. But now we don't need these anymore, because the greater blessings of the new covenant, the greater outpouring, because we have such a greater high priest, that intercessor, and we have him to intercede to the Father. We no longer have, while it was blessings as well in the old covenant, we only had types and shadows of this Christ. We had Aaron as our type of high priest, and the high priest that went in once a year to offer up spiritual sacrifices. And Moses being a type of Christ. Moses being the mediator of that Mosaic economy, etc. and so on. The blessings were spiritual, of course. You don't want to get into this whole, it was purely carnal. But to a much greater degree, it's much more spiritual now. Much more inward and less of the outward. And what is left today? The fulfillment of Lord's table, which is Christ's Passover, is now fulfilled in the Lord's table. The Passover is now replaced with this. This is the way it says it will... you know, these things which are described that will carry on for an everlasting covenant. There's no sign of them finishing. Like circumcision, for example. This continues on in baptism. So these things have... See, there's this kind of, there is a continuity in the whole scriptures. The Puritans, the Westminster divines of the 17th century all saw this. Those of the 17th century, those who involved the Belgian Confession, they all saw this, and to a greater or better degree, I believe strongly the best confession is the Westminster Confession of Faith. So, we need to be careful with this whole idea of Christian liberty, which allows me, as long as I'm convinced in my own mind that it's right, that's not Christian liberty. What did the Westminster Divines write? In chapter 20 of the Westminster Confession of Faith, and this is very, very similar, I won't say its exact wording, in the 1689 London Baptist Confession of Faith. It's not just here either. And this is what I saw, it was what was being represented by most modern arguments of Christian liberty was not understood by Christians before. It says, the liberty which Christ hath purchased for believers under the gospel consists in their freedom. Freedom of what? Freedom from the guilt of sin and condemning wrath of God and curse of the moral law, and in their being delivered from this present evil world, bondage to Satan and dominion of sin, from the evil afflictions and sting of death, the victory of the grave, the everlasting damnation, and also in their free access to God, and their yielding obedience unto him, not out of slavish fear, but a childlike love. I love that statement. But a childlike love and willing mind. They're obeying him, not out of a list. Oh, I must do this, I must do this. And this kind of cold, academic, disconnected, oh, I'll just do this and then I'll not think about God again. But a childlike love, the kind of love that a child has for his parents. That's a special love, a special love that a young child would have. And a willing mind, at which were common also to believers and under the law. But under the New Testament, The liberty of Christians is further enlarged. It is. It's an amazing blessing. In their freedom from the yoke of the ceremony law. The ceremony law has been taken away. And what's been increased is the spiritual blessings. I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Not that the spirit of God wasn't there before, but even greater blessings of his power. The kingdom of God shall come with power, as is described in Mark chapter 9. To which the Jewish church was subjected, and in greater boldness of access to the throne of grace. Greater blessings. It wasn't that they have no access to the throne of grace before, but less so than now. And in fuller communications of the free spirit of God than believers under the law did ordinarily partake of. What is this freedom? What is this liberty? We are set free from the yoke of bondage, sin, to serve him in the way we could never before. We'll never be perfect in this. But this is what Christian liberty is. Number two, God alone is the Lord of the conscience. And this is, you can't judge me. And you see, these concepts, these biblical concepts have been twisted over the years. And hath left it free from the doctrines and commandments of men. See, people talk, when they talk about Christmas, they say, well, no, you don't have to keep it. You're just in a strange cult if you do. You're just like the Jehovah's Witnesses. You know, they'll say one thing, but you just really observe from the vast majority of Christendom, this, you're the damp rag, to quote from Kirk Cameron, who spent most of the last 2 months mocking Christians who will not bow down to the bondage of his man-made tradition. Because why? As the Westminster Confession of Faith writes in paragraph 2 of chapter 20, God alone is the Lord of conscience and hath left it free from the doctrines and commandments of men. We are free from that. Which are in anything contrary to his word or beside it in matters of faith or worship. So that to believe such doctrines or to obey such commandments out of conscience is to betray a true liberty of conscience. And the requiring of an implicit faith and an absolute and binding obedience is to destroy liberty of conscience and reason also. So it cannot be some blind faith. Just because we enjoy it, this is to destroy liberty of conscience. Paragraph 3, they who upon pretense of Christian liberty do practice any sin or cherish any lust, do thereby destroy the end of Christian liberty, which is being delivered out of the hands of our enemies, we might serve the Lord without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our life. This is what it is. We're set free. The opposite to serve sin is bondage. To be set free from these things, this is the freedom to do what? Serve the Lord. How do you serve? Well, you obey his law. You obey him. You follow him. You make the law your delight. You meditate upon it day and night, as the psalmist writes in Psalm 1, verse 2. And finally, just before we move on from this chapter, and I just want to wrap up just some concluding points. And because the powers of paragraph 4, which God hath ordained, and the liberty which Christ hath purchased, are not intended by God to destroy, but mutually to uphold and preserve one another, they who, upon pretense of Christian liberty, shall oppose any lawful power or any lawful exercise, basically talking about the use of power by the church and the state and civil magistrate, etc., and so on, we're not set free from that, but that's not really what has been discussed here. We are set free from any church making a law that we must obey Christmas, because there's no commandment here. People talk about, well, it's your party of Christian liberty. Well, you see, the thing is, it's not, because all the churches, majority, are having services on Christmas Day. It becomes this whole worship service based around the inventions of the brains of men, a violation of the second commandment. just want to quote a few more people on the Second Commandment. James Durham. Let's see what book this is from. James Durham, in The Law Unsealed, Practical Exposition of the Ten Commandments, he states the following: it is a sin not only to worship false gods, but to worship the true God in a false way. Again, the regulative principle of worship, but also to set a day aside which he has not commanded. This is seen in Jeroboam's apostasy. Jeroboam's apostasy is described in a number of places in Scripture. One of the most noteworthy is in 1 Kings, around chapter 11 and 12. There's a number of innovations Jeroboam adds to worship, and it is clear that God is not pleased with what he does. It says in 1 Kings chapter 12, verse 33, on the 15th day of the 8th month, in the month which he devised in his own heart. What Jeroboam did was he set up the time. There was a holy day, which God had ordained, but Jeroboam changed the day of it. He changed the time of it. This was not pleasing to God. Just as a quote from an article written by Brian Schwartley on this topic, Jeroboam apparently took a feast of God's appointing, the Feast of Tabernacles, and merely changed the keeping of it from the 15th day of the 7th month to the 15th day of the 8th month. God does not tell us why Jeroboam changed the month, but the fact that he changed the change originated in Jeroboam's heart and not from God's word is emphasized by the Holy Spirit and shows God's disapprobation of any human autonomy in worship. And then again, it is a violation of the Second Commandment. We are not to use the thoughts of our own brains. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not in thine own understanding. Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. We're supposed to rest in him, not as it's at the end of Ecclesiastes chapter, I think it's chapter 7 or chapter 8, the man was created upright, righteous, but sought after many inventions. Let's talk about Adam, created in right standing before God, but fell from his original state and sought after inventions. If it's not from the word of God, it's an invention. Regardless of whether we talk about the first, second, or third, fourth commandment, whatever it is, how we approach God must be according to his set holy day, which day we set apart, the way he is pleasing to him. Because what happens? People love Christmas and hate the Lord's Day. This is today. People hate the idea. People want any excuse not to observe the Lord's Day. Oh, that's just for the Jews. They hate that, but they love Christmas. They love the thoughts, the imagination, the inventions of men's brains. And then they'll say, well, you know, Christian liberty. Well, Christian liberty is where we are set free from the bondage of sin. Oh, sure, there are much greater, we don't have as many limitations, we don't have the ceremonial law, and we use a prudence. You know, this is, you know, over, it doesn't say how many, you know, say, glasses of wine to drink, but we should use wisdom to say, well, not to go anywhere near any state of drunkenness, to err always on the side of caution. The Spirit of God does not give us a spirit of fear, but of love, and a power, and a kind of a self-discipline. If you're being controlled by the Spirit of God, you're a disciplined kind of person. You're not all over the place. You're not given to passions. You're not led by your emotions, etc., and so on. This Christian liberty argument is really antinomianism. Antinomianism, where we're not under the law anymore. Well, that doesn't apply to us. Christ has already fulfilled that. There's no standard for us to fulfill. You know, it doesn't matter how terrible we do. You know, what does this show if we completely deny him and we don't love his law? To an antinomian as well, you know, Christ has already purchased him and it doesn't matter in his performance. It doesn't matter in his performance in terms of justification. But if he is a new creature, he will produce and live a different life. He'll produce fruit that will reflect that he's a new creature in Christ. There's no doubt about it. The Bible is replete with this. The warning to those unconverted sinners in Matthew chapter 7 verses, it's 2021. Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I never knew you. You work iniquity. The fruit of your life is iniquity, your lawlessness. You lived as if I never gave you a law to obey. No, you're not saved on the justification is something that Christ achieves and as a declaration of forensic righteousness imputed to your account. True. But if we are not being sanctified by the Spirit of God, we're not the children of God. We cannot, in any way, shape, or form, with any confidence, ever say we are His children, unless the Spirit of God is making us, is sanctifying us by His truth, for His Word is truth. So we can't use that argument. Either it has been commanded, especially in the area of holy days. God is not silent on holy days. God is not silent on how He is worshipped. I just pray this time of year that we would pull ourselves away from the trinkets and the flashiness that is distracting us and drawing us away from God's true holy day. And then we will not say, well, you know what, it's up to the person, it's Christian liberty. No, it's not. And it's a false understanding of Christian liberty, because the Bible is not silent on anything that has to do with our spiritual benefit. It's not. We may not have the answers yet. We may not have seen what the scriptures are saying about this, but let us not say that the Bible is silent. Let us see what we can determine, what we can learn from the scriptures of good and necessary consequence. This has been Paul Flynn. Probably talk to you in the new year, unless there's any major news stories that are in between now and about the 2nd of January. May God bless you all. Email me, megiddofilms@gmail.com. Check the YouTube page. There may be in between now and then, over the next week and a little bit, there may be vlogs as well, if there's any interesting things that people send me on. You can also send them to my Facebook page, but also megiddofilms@gmail.com is probably the best place, and probably will be some vlogs over the next week and a half. Thank you so much for tuning in, supporting the radio show. May God bless you all. Talk to you soon.